Okay, so in the last lecture, we were looking at linear quadratic regulator problem. So we have taken the most basic model in the beginning. This is the model which is free of measurement noise, any state disturbance. Somehow, the initial state is not equal to origin. And the problem is to move the system from a non-zero initial state to zero initial state. That is the simplest of the problem that we have been looking at. Well, of course, I'll slowly relax all these assumptions and then move towards a problem which is complete, in which we consider disturbances, not only just simple disturbances, but drifting disturbances. We'll talk about regulation at any arbitrary set point. So all that we will do, okay, but let's begin with the simplest problem. So this is right now deterministic model A, B and C are known to me, okay. Let's assume that the system is reachable, which means I can move the system from any initial condition to any final condition. And now I want to find out a control law, okay, that will move the system from initial point to origin. That is the problem right now being posed. We said that this problem is now going to be posed as an optimization problem. The reason for posing it as an optimization problem is twofold. One is that optimization framework, particularly this one which we are going to develop, will ensure two things. It will also ensure the stability, it will also ensure performance. The optimization objective function allows us to specify performance. So here, this term here is square of the distance from the origin. So this is weighted norm of x vector. This weighting matrix W is typically a diagonal matrix, and it is used to do scaling of the variables. That is one thing. Second thing is also used to tell which error should go to zero fast. There are two purposes that this weighting matrix serves. One is, you know, different states can have different numerical values, so you can make them sort of on the same footing by multiplying by a scaling factor. Second thing is, you can specify relative importance. If you give higher weight, okay, that means that error should go to zero fast. Okay, so in systems where states have physical meaning, you can specify that this particular, you know, this concentration should go to should be controlled faster. Some level, you don't care if it is oscillating a little bit. So you can actually do a trade-off by specifying this weighting matrix. Same is true about this second term here. Second term is trying to weigh the input efforts. Okay, you don't want very large input efforts. Also, you have trade-offs in inputs. You know, some inputs are costly to manipulate. Some inputs are cheap to manipulate. For example, it is quite likely that if I am manipulating in some system steam and cooling water and a coolant system, it might be cheaper to manipulate coolant than manipulating steam, because steam, you know, you need energy cost. Cooling water, just pumping cost, you know. So you might use cooling water liberally, but not use steam liberally. So all those things can be actually incorporated by choosing this matrix W, U. This is again typically a diagonal matrix. This is not going to be a, so diagonal matrix, diagonal elements are all positive. These are all positive definite matrices. And they will give you relative importance of each, or, you know, if you, here it's other way around. If you put large weight on a particular input, that input will not change too much. Okay, that input will not change too much, but because your decision variables are U. So suppose U1, first component of U, has a large weight associated with it in matrix WU, then the first component will not change too much, because if you change first component, the cost function will change by a large amount. Okay, so you can specify a relative importance of each manipulated variable. All these things are very difficult to do when you do pole placement. You cannot say place the poles such that input 1 is not changing too fast, but input 2 is changing fast. All these things become very difficult coming to pole placement design. But it is possible to do this using optimization framework, because optimization framework is directly relates to time domain specification. You can very easily give you know, translate your control requirements into a optimization problem. That is not so difficult. Okay. So the third term is, of course, waiting on the terminal or the final state. Now, how is this problem solved? Okay. So solution is found by this Zimmerman's dynamic programming. Okay, so this is a famous method, dynamic programming, which was developed by Bellman, and then it has been used very widely in optimization or optimization based schemes. The idea here is very simple, that you work here backward in time. So you first see here the problem. If you go back here, if you look here, this problem is posed over a finite time 0 to time n is the final time. So you want to reach close to the origin in n, capital N samples. Capital N is not equal to state dimension. Capital N is some number. Okay, so this problem is posed for a finite time. Okay, we will then relax this also. We'll then, because the real systems, you know, let's say some chemical plant or a power plant, it doesn't work. In reality, it works for finite time. But you cannot develop a controller which will be for, you know, 1 year and solve it. So here, right now, even though N has been used, we will first develop a method for N, and then we'll say N goes to infinity and derive asymptotic results. Okay, that's what is going to be done. Okay. So what is done here in dynamic programming, you start from the end. So you start from nth sample, okay, the last sample. You choose an optimal input for the last sample. Having chosen optimal input for the last sample, you move back in time to n minus 1. Okay, then choose an optimal input for n minus 1. Having chosen for n and n minus 1, you move back in time to n minus 2. Okay, in optimal state estimation, in Kalman filtering, we are moving forward in time. Okay, we are moving forward in time. Now here, you have specified, you know, the final time, and then you are moving backward in time. So you have to have some patience before you finish. Okay, I'm sure I can see a question on your face. How can you specify final time? Well, just wait. Okay, look at the development, and then we will come back to. Okay. Now let's define this quantity, this matrix S. Okay, this is a matrix S which is defined as Wn. What is Wn? Wn here is this weight here on the terminal state. Okay, so Wn is a positive definite matrix which is the weighting on the final state. Okay, that is after n times. That is the. So I am starting this algorithm with Wn, and then look at what I have to solve. I want to minimize this jk, okay, starting from time k to time n minus 1. Okay, I want to choose time k to time n minus 1. Summation, see, this problem has been defined from k equal to 0 to k equal to n minus 1. And now I am starting at some point k. Okay. So at k equal to n, only this last term remains. You see this? See, I have this summation. Here. Go back here. I think this one index is wrong. It should be k equal to k equal to 0. So this last term is what remains. See, if I want to optimize this backward in time, okay, first I should consider the last term. So last term is this term, right? Last term is this term. Yeah. No, so the Bellman's principle is this. So you start with the last term and you move backward in time. You optimize the last term. Having optimized last term, then you optimize last but one. Then having optimized those two, you move backward in time and then you go to zero. That is Bellman's, that's a method. Okay. How it will lead to a controller design, we'll see that. Just it's a tool. Okay. No. So you actually solve, you actually formulate, you break it into multiple optimization problems. Okay. This is one giant optimization problem. Okay. See, this problem here is a giant optimization problem. It's from the U0 to UN minus 1, you want to decide everything. Okay. Now UN minus 1, see, look at this particular system. There is a time evolution thing here. Why we are able to use this particular concept of Bellman's dynamic principle? See, UN minus 1, you just tell me, if I am optimizing this particular problem, UN minus 1, is it going to affect, say, X0 or X1 or X2? It is not. The UN minus term will only affect Xn. Okay? So actually, choosing an optimum UN minus 1 can be solved independently of, you know, U0 to UN minus 2. Okay. So you fix UN minus 1 optimally. Having fixed UN minus 1 optimally, you move to UN minus 2. UN minus 2 is not going to again affect things in the past. It's going to affect only future. Okay. So you move backward. So you take advantage of this particular fact. Okay. To break this problem, one giant problem, into sequence of smaller problems. Okay, and then that will lead you to a very elegant solution to this particular problem. Okay, so what I'm going to say here is, so this is starting from any arbitrary k, k can be 0. If k is 0, it reduces to the original problem. I've written it here from any arbitrary k. Why this is written from arbitrary k will become clear as we go on. Okay, I'm defining this term jk. I'm defining two things, Sn and jk. Jk is a problem starting from time k to time n minus 1. So this is a kth subproblem. This is a kth subproblem. So I am going to solve, actually, instead of one big optimization problem, I am going to solve a connected series of optimization problems. And that will lead me to the solution. So I am defining two things, Sn and jk. Okay. So according to this definition, this here, what you have here, this is J0. This is J0 because J0 to n minus 1. Okay? This is J0. And what is Jn? Jn is the last term. Okay? Jn will be only this term. Okay? Jn will be the last term. Only the last term. Okay. So what is Jn minus 1? Jn minus 1 is Xn minus 1 transpose Wx, Xn minus 1, plus this U term plus Jn. Right? Okay. So what I'm going to do next? So this last term I'm substituting in terms of UN minus 1. What is the decision variable here? See, what is the decision variable for the last term? It's only UN minus 1. Okay? I only have to choose UN minus 1 because UN minus 1 will have effect on Xn. Okay? So my Jn is now written in terms of Xn minus 1, UN minus 1. Sn is Wn. You have defined this. Okay? And this is the term that I want to minimize with respect to UN minus 1. Okay. So if I minimize this, now you have to expand this, right? What I have done here is, you know, there will be four terms, right? This is just matrix multiplication. You just multiply and then rearrange. And then you will get this, in between thing. This is not very difficult to get. So this is just multiplication and rearrangement. And the first term, see if you see here, this first term here, okay, xn minus 1 transpose this term, this is xn minus 1 transpose xn minus 1. This cannot be influenced by, can this be influenced by un minus 1? This cannot be, okay. So this term is ruled out, this cannot be influenced by un minus 1. Only this term and this term, these last three terms can be influenced by un minus 1. So actually when you minimize, you only worry, have to worry about 1, 2 and 3, okay. Is it okay? There are four terms, x transpose x, okay, x transpose u, u transpose x and u transpose u. So last three terms are relevant, first term is not relevant, okay, because first term cannot be influenced by un minus 1. It can be influenced by un minus 2, un minus 3, that's a different story. It cannot be influenced by un minus 1, okay. Which one? Yeah, so Jn I have defined. So I am going to define this Jk, no? So the first you define the last term, that is Jn. Then what is Jn minus 1? Jn minus 1 is Jn plus one more term. Okay, what is Jn minus 2? 2, Jn, Jn minus 1, 2, I mean there will be three terms. Okay, and when you collect from J0 will be collection of all terms from n to 0. No. Right now, so this is an intermediate step in the derivation. Just don't try to right now interpret. Okay. So, right now n, even though I am saying it is final time, the system may not have reached the final state 0 at time n. So, you may not have become 0. So, just see the derivation. Okay. So this, with this Jn and this Jn minus 1, is everyone with me on this? I have just combined, added terms together and clubbed the terms of un minus 1 and xn minus 1. They have separated them and then written it like this, okay? So this last term cannot be influenced. And then, how am I going to solve this problem? Okay, I have to solve this problem of minimizing this function with respect to un minus 1. Okay, so this is done by method of completing squares. Okay, so just keep that jn minus 1 business aside, look at this now. Consider a scalar quadratic function. Okay, just look at these steps. Are you convinced here? What has been done? Just see that, just try to derive this. Can you derive this? See this form, what I have done is, I have written this abstract form here. See what is the abstract form? X transpose something into U, U transpose something into X, U transpose a positive definite matrix into U. So there are three terms, U transpose U, U transpose X, X transpose U. Okay, so I can now think of, see, this is like a multi-dimensional quadratic equation. Okay, I want to convert it into a complete square. Okay, if I can write it as sum of two squares, okay, then I can use that to solve the problem. That is the idea. Okay, so just see whether you can derive this. Just see if this result can be derived. Just check. Just do the algebra. So if you have a scalar function in abstract form, see that A and what is A matrix and all is very, very cumbersome. Okay, leave it aside right now. Just see whether you can derive this result. Okay. U transpose AU plus Z transpose U plus U transpose Z. So second step is very obvious. The third step would require expansion. The third step requires expansion. Okay? How will you find the minimum of this function? Pardon me? No. See, this is this, what is A? A is a positive definite matrix. That is very, very important. So what about A inverse? A inverse is also a positive definite matrix. Okay. So what is the property of a positive definite matrix? X transpose any vector transpose A into that vector will always be a positive quantity. Okay. So this is a positive quantity. This is always a positive quantity for any x, any u. This is always a positive quantity by virtue of the fact that A is positive definite. What about this guy? This is also a positive quantity. Okay. What is the lowest value this function can take? No. What is the decision variable? My decision variable is u. My decision variable is u. Z is some vector. See, actually, here, map. What will you map? You map u to un minus 1. You map u to un minus 1. And this entire thing, x transpose, phi transpose, sn into gamma, that you can map to z. Okay? That you can map to z. So we'll see what is that mapping. Okay. So what is the minimum value it can take? The minimum value it can take, if I have to minimize this function with respect to u, it's a function of u. Z is some vector which is constant. Yeah. So if you can put this equal to 0, see, if you put this term equal to 0, this A is a positive definite matrix. So the smallest value this term can take is 0. When will you take it 0? Only when this vector is 0. Okay. So the minimum value is this. Okay. That is when you choose u is equal to minus a inverse z. Okay. So now just do this mapping. Choose A to be this matrix, gamma transpose Sn gamma plus Wu. Okay. This is the matrix which appeared in U transpose part. Okay. And choose Z to be gamma transpose Sn phi Xn minus 1. Okay. If you do this, what is the solution? A inverse, so inverse of this matrix, okay, into Z. Z is, do you get this? A inverse, A is a, will A always be invertible? This A, will it be always invertible? Why? Sn is Wn, okay, Wn is a positive definite matrix. So, is A always a positive definite matrix? Sn is a positive definite matrix. Gamma transpose Sn gamma is a positive definite matrix. Wu is a positive definite matrix. Okay. So addition of two positive definite matrices will give you a positive definite matrix. Okay. So this A is a positive definite matrix. So A is invertible. Okay. And you get this. So my controller can be written like this. This is A inverse. See, look at here. A inverse, okay, times this whole thing into X. Actually, what I am getting is a state feedback control law. What I wanted to derive was a state feedback controller. Okay, I got state feedback control law for one particular instant. So what was this particular matrix? This A minus A inverse into this matrix is the gain. Okay, is the gain, and Xn, this is the state feedback controller. Okay, is everyone clear about this? So which gives minimum loss function to be equal to this. If you actually substitute and find out the minimum of Jn minus 1, Jn minus will turn out to be this, where Sn minus 1 is actually, I have just done the algebra. Okay, you can go back and substitute and see how it works. So what I have done here, just go back and see here. See, I had this, I wanted to minimize this function. Okay. So I am just doing it by completing the square. Okay. I am not worried about this part because this first term is not going to be influenced by W. Okay. So to find out the minimum for the remaining three part, what I have done is I have expressed it as sum of two squares. This is one square, this is another square. So this is always a positive number, this is always a positive number. Okay. The smallest value this can take is zero. Okay. And then I just chose A to be this and Z to be this. Okay. This gives me a minimum of the original objective function. I go back and substitute the optimum value of U, and then so this is my state feedback. This is my optimum UN minus 1, okay, which is this matrix times XN minus 1. Okay. Now this is the result which you would have got even by minimization. If you had done dou by dou U, you would have got the same result. Okay. Why do we need Bellman's principle? We'll come to that. So this is a local result for one you can get by minimization. Bellman's principle talks about the series of connected problems. Okay. So that's where. So if you actually take this solution, what is the minimum value of Jn minus 1? Substitute this solution into the you know that Jn minus 1 expression. You will get this. But Jn and Jn minus 1 I combined into one, no? Because Jn and Jn minus 1 both will be influenced by Un minus 1. See, Un minus 1 appears in two terms. Okay. It appears in Jn minus 1 by virtue of the fact of the definition of the objective function. It appears in Jn because Un minus 1 influences Xn. Okay. So actually, if you go back here, see, Jn is only this, but un minus 1 appears in jn minus 1 because the way of optimization problem is defined. See the optimization problem is defined with respect to, see, what is jn? Only xn. Okay, what is jn minus 1? This also contains this term. So I have grouped all the terms that contain un minus 1 together. Okay, so that is the reason I looked at Jn minus 1. Okay, and I optimize Jn minus 1 with respect to Un minus 1. Okay, and that optimum Un is found to be this. Okay, I am going to call this particular time varying matrix as Gn minus 1. Okay, this is my notation, and when I substitute this particular solution into Jn minus 1, I get this quantity. Okay, this is pure algebra. I just took this solution, substituted it there. Whatever term I get, okay, that I am calling as Sn minus 1. My intention here is to derive a recurrent relationship between Sn minus 1, Gn minus 1, Sn minus 1, Gn minus 1. You remember what we did in Kalman filtering? We had covariance and we had Kalman gain, and they were coupled with each other. Okay, Kalman gain, okay, is based on the covariance update. Okay, then you again update the, you have predicted covariance, Kalman gain calculation, updated covariance. Again, you do Kalman gain calculation, predicted covariance, it goes in a cycle. Okay. So likewise here, I want to derive a recurrent relationship in time, okay, which are again called as Riccati equations, except now it is done in the context of control rather than in the context of state estimation. So now having optimized Jn minus 1, you move to Jn minus 2. You are moving backward in time. Okay. So now I want to minimize this term here, Jn minus 2, with reference to un minus 2, because I have, see, this term here is influenced by un minus 2, okay, and here this is influenced by un minus 1, okay, and so this has already been optimized, except there is one thing here, which is influenced by un minus 2. What is it? Xn minus 1. See, look at this, relationship. Here, I want to point out that they are actually analogous. See here, this is xn minus 1, Sn minus 1, Xn. So this term will appear here. Earlier we had Xn minus 1 and Jn, okay, you just shift in time, okay, and you have already chosen un minus 1, so now only you have to choose optimally un minus 2, okay, so algebra is messy, you know, if you sit down and do it, it's not difficult to do this algebra, but just understand the concept. If you are getting stuck anywhere, please stop me, okay, so again, okay, again, see, this expression looks very, very similar, except this matrix here has become little complex. This Sn minus 1 is now a very complex expression. You see this? Okay, apart from that, see, if you accept that somehow this Sn minus 1 is coming from the one step ahead in time, okay, then this expression is philosophically same. I mean, it's the same expression. Okay, so you have this term, and then you have n minus 1. What is in the n minus 1 that you can influence using un minus 2? Xn minus 1. Okay? See, earlier what was the case? Even here, when it was Jn, it was Xn into Xn transpose some matrix, Xn transpose. Okay? So, U term was not there in the last term. Here also, now after you implement this control law, U term is not there, you just have this optimal Jn minus 1, which is where this Sn minus 1 is given by this big matrix here, okay. So now how do I minimize this? Again same thing, complete the squares, okay. Now using this term, okay. So if you complete the squares, you go back in time, okay, like this, by completing the squares, you get what are called as Riccati equations. Okay, these Riccati equations are moving backward in time, okay. So, where G is given by this and Sn, so your controller is found like this. You start from Sn, okay, Sn is equal to WL, okay. Then for that you find out GK. That is your controller gain at time instant capital N. Capital N is the last time in your optimization problem. Okay. So you find this GN. Okay. For the time being, keep aside the fact that how will you implement this? Just look at it as a, you know, optimization procedure. Okay. We first fix UN minus 1. Having fixed UN minus 1, we go and fix UN minus 2. Having fixed un minus 1, un minus 2, we fix un minus 3. So we go backward in time. Okay. So actually, what we are getting here is a series of time-varying gain matrices. You don't get a control law with a fixed gain. You get, see, just like in Kalman filter, we got gain matrices that are changing as a function of time. Okay. So here too, you get a sequence of gain matrices that are changing with time. They are coupled with each other through these Riccati equations. Okay, through these Riccati equations. Except that you start from capital N, that is the last time, and you go backward in time, and you will get a series of gain matrices. Okay. Now a practical problem you might ask is that what do I do? I mean, suppose I am running some plant, okay, let's say I want to drive a motor automatically on some road, and every 1 second I have to take a decision, and I have to go from here to the other, and if it takes a, 1 hour or 2 hours to go to, 1 hour to go to the other, so do I actually compute 3600 gain matrices? Do I save them? And then at each time point, I just retrieve one gain matrix, multiply and find the controller. That is impractical. Okay, so we will sort this problem out. Don't worry about this right now. Yeah. I finally want to reach xn is equal to 0. No. So now aim in this particular case is not xn is equal to 0. In this particular case is to make xn as small as possible, very close to 0. Asymptotically, I want to go to xn is equal to 0. This is for any arbitrary xn. Now what we will do is we'll say that under certain conditions, you can find us. See, this is a coupled equation. Okay, this is a difference equation. See, why it is a difference equation? K depends upon K plus 1. See, normally you are used to difference equations which move forward in time. This difference equation moves backward in time. Okay, this difference equation moves backward in time. What is elegant about this solution is that you have a closed form solution. Okay, you get sequence of optimal gain matrices. Okay, and you get a closed form solution. Now this is not practical because many times you do not know how many. Suppose you are going from here to the other. You want to automate your car and leave it on the road. You cannot predict what time it will take. Whether it will take 1 hour, 20 minutes, or 2 hours, depends upon the road conditions. So unless in some cases if you are hitting some target and you are going to hit a particular target in so many seconds, then probably you can pre-calculate all the gain matrices, keep them, and then it will do the job. But this is not practical. But this gives you a recurrent formula, and how will I use this next will become clear next. So let me just summarize this first. How do I calculate this? So my feedback gain is GK, and then GK is calculated by this recurrent relationship. These are appearing here in the this difference equation back in time, and then what is guaranteed is this SK is always a symmetric and positive definite matrix, because you start with SN is equal to WN. This is a symmetric positive definite matrix, and the way the whole thing is constructed, you are guaranteed that this SN matrix SN will always be symmetric and positive definite. But the problem here is that n should be known a priori. How many such gain matrices you find out? Okay. So, but now for the time being, leave that aside. You got a way of calculating the optimal solution. Okay. We will find the asymptotic solution of this particular problem by letting n go to infinity. Okay. We'll find that solution. And we'll use that solution to, I just want to draw a parallel to EKF. You remember what we did in EKF? In EKF, we had this solution which was large time solution or infinite solution. Okay, so in this case, we just said that this goes to infinity, and then time goes to infinity, as k goes to infinity, the solution converges to a steady state problem, okay? And then you can get here, you can get L star infinity, okay? You can get this infinite time gain, which is only one matrix, okay? So this way you don't have to compute LK matrix at every time instant, because after some time, when you program this, you will realize that after some time, this LK goes to a steady state. You don't have to actually keep computing it every time, all these matrix equations. So they under certain conditions, of course, on observability and so on. So I had talked about Kalman predictor. You remember Kalman predictor? In Kalman predictor, we had two equations. We had gain update, covariance update, right? We had gain update and covariance update. And then this LP star was the optimal gain, and then we computed this gain for moving forward in time. And then we had, of course, conditions under which, you have this coupled equations, and you can solve this algebraic Riccati equations. You can solve them, the solution exists, and I talked about this lemma, which tells you under what conditions the solutions exist, when this phi square root q is controllable and r is non-singular, then a unique solution exists such that eigenvalues of this matrix are inside unit circle. So we had solved this problem earlier, and I just want to draw analogy here. See, there are two things here, this covariance update or covariance equation and the gain equation, and they are coupled. Okay, same thing is happening here if you just look carefully. At least this LQG notes I will upload today. Okay, see here, there are two coupled equations. This is something like covariance update. This is something like covariance update. Qualitatively, this is similar to covariance update. This is similar to gain, Kalman gain update. So this is a gain calculation, covariance calculation. Similarly here, this SN calculation and gain calculation. Okay. So now, what I'm going to do is to let SK go to S infinity. What happens is that GK will go to G infinity. This will happen only under certain conditions of controllability and, like we had conditions for algebraic Riccati equations for the Kalman filter, same thing will be holding here. So you can show that under certain conditions, this coupled set of equations have a solution, and this equation is actually G infinity. Okay, let's call it G infinity, this gain. So now, if you solve this coupled equations, you have one gain matrix which is optimal when n goes to infinity. Okay, and for practical implementation, all that derivation which I did, I'm not going to use. I'm going to use this algebraic Riccati equation, find out g infinity, and use it for my control. Okay, so that starting with last point, going backward in time, all that was in between step. All that was an in-between step. Okay. Now that I have derived it, I am interested in this infinite solution. Okay. And this infinite solution is what I am going to use for designing my. So this is the state feedback controller which I have now. Okay. How do you solve this? This coupled equation can be solved under just like you had conditions there, you have conditions here. Okay. If you consider if phi and gamma is controllable, there we had a condition of observability. Phi and c were observable. Here you have phi and gamma is controllable. Okay, and this matrix, WU matrix, okay, if you take this square root of WU matrix, and if this is observable, yes, so you take square root of that. Okay, this is called square root. This omega is called the square. You know about LU decomposition? A positive definite matrix can be written as L transpose L transpose L. So this is a diagonal matrix, so it will be just square root. W will typically be a diagonal matrix. So this will be just a diagonal matrix. That. Okay. So if this pair is observable, and if this pair is controllable, okay, then you can guarantee that there exists a unique solution to this particular problem. So this problem has a unique solution, and you will get a unique gain matrix G infinity, which will stabilize the closed loop. Okay, which will bring the system from non-zero initial condition to zero initial condition. Okay, which will ensure that the poles of, see, if I substitute this control law, what is the closed loop solution? What is the closed loop behavior? Is this okay? Is everyone with me on this? Correct. So now I'll prove stability. Okay. I'll show that asymptotic this using this controller is equivalent to I will prove asymptotic stability with this controller. Okay. If it is asymptotically stable, it should go to zero. Yeah? So well, while doing the derivation, whether I started by saying xn is equal to zero or not is a different story. All that I said when I started the derivation, that xn should be as small as possible. I'm minimizing your objective function with respect to use. Okay, so my objective there was to choose input such that xn is as small as possible. Okay, I didn't set it equal to zero. Okay, I didn't set it equal to zero. I just said that it should be very small. No, but I don't have to choose now, no. See, I have just now got rid of that xn business. See, now I'm just going to say that n goes to infinity. Let n go to infinity. Okay. Then I actually have to solve this problem, this coupled equation. Okay. So that xn and all that business was an intermediate step to derive this algebraic Riccati equation. Okay. Solution of the algebraic Riccati equation is going to give me g infinity, which I'm going to use as my control law. Is everyone clear on this? All that dynamic programming and all that I did just as an intermediate step to derive this particular control law. Okay. But this is a state feedback control law. The state feedback control law. Okay. Yeah. So that is, for existence of solution of that particular equation, you have to have two conditions met. You can go and check this proof in the one of the standard texts which I'll be listing at the end of the. So the proof is very elaborate. I don't want to get into the proof. So this is I'm just quoting the, I have not written as a theorem, but in any book, this will be a theorem which talks about conditions under which the solution exists for the algebraic Riccati equations. See, this is a matrix, coupled matrix equation. It is not an easy equation to solve. Okay. So because this G is a matrix, S is a matrix, and these are coupled equations. So solving this matrix equation is a tough problem. And then there has been a lot of work on how to solve such Riccati equations. And so you can just, I will refer you to the books where. Oh yeah, Cholesky decomposition. Any W you can write Cholesky. Because in MATLAB we have a function called Cholesky. That is standard. See, the nice thing about all these things is you can just use linear algebra. It's ultimately just algebra, linear algebra, simple linear algebra that you applied. You can view this entire control theory as, in state space the domain as applied linear algebra. Just, so is everyone clear with this? Now, U is G infinity times this. So my closed loop becomes this. Okay? Is this clear? I don't see a lot of convinced people. I can go over it again. You tell me where you are stuck, which part you didn't understand. See, See, let's look at it like this. I started doing this derivation. Let's go over it again. So then what I do is, once I do this, I ignore the fact that gain is time varying. I just look at gain as n goes to infinity. I'm just finally interested in deriving the algebraic Riccati equation. For that, I'm doing this as an intermediate step. How to arrive at the algebraic Riccati equation? So I'm starting with unsteady state case. Okay, where n, capital N, is some intermediate point. You have not reached the origin yet. Okay, capital N is some intermediate point. Okay, I have not specified N. Okay, I use this only to derive this recurrent relationship. See, what is the recurrent relationship? The recurrent relationship is between this. I mean, finally, you know, you got, let's go to the, yeah. So I just wanted to derive this recurrent relationship between the gain and this positive definite matrix SK. This is not covariance here. This is not covariance, but in the Kalman filter derivation, this is somewhat similar to the covariance update. So this matrix update and gain update, matrix update and gain update. That's how you got this equation. And then finally, what I'm interested is not in this time varying solution. I'm interested in the solution which is as n goes to infinity. Okay, so I'm interested in the steady state solution. And then finally, I'm never going to implement a control law like this where GK is time varying. I'm interested in this control law where I'm interested in this control law. Okay, so all that dynamic programming I have just used as an intermediate step to arrive at this algebraic Riccati equation. Algebraic Riccati equations give me, okay, see now here, you know, going back in time, everything has vanished, because here, when the solution is converged, SK plus 1 and SK are same, right? When the solution is converged, there is no difference between SK plus 1 and SK. So that's why steady state solution, there is nothing like moving back in time or moving forward in time. It's the steady state solution. So I'm just interested in finding out the steady state gain. I have used that final n as a vehicle to arrive at this steady state solution. Okay, and then I am stating you the, giving you the conditions under which the steady state solution exists. Okay, yeah. So maybe first few samples it is not, but as if you take n to be very large, then it is optimal. Okay, so this g infinity is optimal g infinity. Okay. So this is my closed loop solution. Okay, now I want to show that this is asymptotically stable. Okay, I want to show that if I prove asymptotic stability, okay, then you know, yeah. Then see, we have seen one thing for Lyapunov functions. If eigenvalues of this matrix are inside the unit circle, okay, then you can always construct a Lyapunov function, okay, whose you know, derivative is negative and strictly negative, and you will the system will be asymptotically stable, and vice versa. So poles inside the unit circle and ability to construct a Lyapunov function for a linear system, time invariant system, are synonymous. So if I construct a Lyapunov function for this, it implies that the poles are inside the unit circle. For linear systems, these two things are equivalent, asymptotic stability and being able to construct a Lyapunov function, okay, for the particular system. So instead of trying to find out the poles of this system and show that they are inside the unit circle, I'm going to construct a Lyapunov function and show that, you know, the Lyapunov functions, you know, rate of change of Lyapunov function is negative definite. So this is asymptotically stable system, which means the poles of phi minus gamma g omega have to be inside unit circle. So this is stable, asymptotically stable. Okay, that is the argument I'm going to use. So I'm constructing this, function v of x, which is xk transpose s infinity. S infinity is a positive definite matrix, by the way. Okay, s infinity is always a positive definite matrix. So what do you have to do to find out, prove the Lyapunov stability? Find out the difference between two successive values of the Lyapunov function. So this is vk plus 1 and this is vk. Okay, so is everyone with me on this? I am just substituting for the closed loop. Okay, so this becomes, this becomes negative definite, because look at this term, xk transpose phi s infinity xk, will it disappear or I have missed out some algebra in between? Yeah, there is an algebra in between, right? Because phi will come, phi transpose. Yeah, I have to find out the in between algebra. You can work out this algebra. The expressions are correct. Okay, you have to see how one step I have. So this Wx plus G transpose W is a positive definite matrix. So you can show that defining this Lyapunov function, okay, you have this delta Vx, which is positive definite. So I'm just worried about one term. We have to go back and check. I'll just check this and confirm. Okay. So the argument that I want to make here is that the closed loop system is asymptotically stable for any choice of Wx and Wu. That is very, very important. I choose these weighting matrices to be positive definite but arbitrary. Okay. Now in reality you will not choose them arbitrarily, but you are guaranteed to get a stable controller, stable closed loop behavior for arbitrary choice of Wx and Wu. Okay. For any x of any Wx, Wu, you will always get this matrix to be positive definite, and then I think you have to simplify this using G infinity. So you have to use that expression for G infinity. G infinity expression is pretty complex. G infinity expression is this, right? G infinity expression is this, and you have to substitute and then expand to get. So from here to here, you have to do a lot of algebra. Okay, it is not obvious. It is not obvious from the this. So from here to here, I have missed out a lot of in between steps. You can sit and work out by substituting for G infinity that expression on the previous slide, and then do a huge expansion, and then cancel all the terms that appear. And so we'll have to do a lot of work to arrive from here to here. Okay, but that is not important for us. That algebra is not so important. Don't worry about the algebra. This is a standard textbook material now. This was worked out way back. And this is, since it is positive definite, you just, for the time being, what is important to know is that this expression can be reduced to this simple expression here. And since this is positive definite, this positive definite matrix, so x transpose this into x, this whole term is always positive and negative of that is always negative. Okay. So you can construct a Lyapunov function for this particular system, and if this is negative definite, then for any choice, you know, we will get a stable closed loop behavior. Okay. The nice thing about this particular controller is that it not only guarantees stability, it also guarantees performance. Because how is the performance defined? Through the objective function. You have given an objective function. Okay. So choosing those Wx, Wu matrices makes sure that you have desired performance translated into an objective function. Okay, and then that gets accounted for when you do the gain calculations. So this is, like I said, this is just placing the poles inside the unit circle is just like saying that, you know, you have passed the course, you are above 4. But here, you know, you are ensuring both performance and stability. You are above 4 and then you are the topper. Okay. So by choosing this WXWU, you have to have some experience as to how to choose WXWU. You can actually shape the speed of recovery from non-zero initial condition to zero initial condition. You can choose priorities, you can prioritize different inputs. You can actually give more importance to one input and less importance to another input and all kinds of things you can do. So you can weight a costly input more and not allow it to move too much. If steam is costly, okay, don't change it too much. All that can be done by choosing these weighting matrices. That is, yeah. So G infinity can, see now, actually when you solve it, when you calculate, you don't do all that optimization. That is just a derivation. When I'm asking you to now, the next problem is that implement quadratic optimal controller on the system that you are, okay. So what you have to do is not do all this optimization. What you have to do is take this particular problem. You just define WU, you define WX, okay. Define WU, define WX, and then give it to MATLAB. There is a subroutine called ARE, algebraic Riccati equations. Okay, you just give phi, gamma, WX, WU. Okay, see what all things you have to specify. Phi, you have to give phi matrix, gamma matrix, WX, and WU. If these four things are given, okay, MATLAB subroutine ARE will solve, or Scilab will be, there will be some other subroutine equivalent to this. It will solve this problem, algebraic Riccati equations, and it will give you these two things. What it will give you back? G infinity and S infinity, both it will give you. Okay, of course, you should make sure that these conditions are met. Phi and gamma should be controllable, okay, and choose WU such that this pair is observable. What is observable, what is controllable, both you know now. Okay, so now you make sure these conditions are met. So ultimately, the working recipe is that this one slide. All that was the derivation. Yeah, but typically this asymptotic solution, if you start programming, so if you take a Kalman filter, okay, I'm going to run this plant for, you know, let's say I'm doing it every 1 second interval, I'm doing calculations. I'm going to run plant for 20 days, okay. So actually it's like saying k goes to infinity because, you know, within some 100 samples, the gain will saturate and you will get a steady state solution. Similarly, if you start here, if you start solving the dynamic Riccati equations, okay, you will find that in some n equal to 100, you will hit G infinity, S infinity. So you will get the steady state solution with no time, you know. So those first, see, suppose I'm going to run a plant for, you know, 20,000 time steps. And if the gain saturates to G infinity within first 100, okay, I ignore first 100. I'm not so much worried about 1 to 100 being non-optimal. If 100 to 20,000 is optimal, I'm willing to, you know, sacrifice on 1 to 100 not being optimal. Okay? So long time solution, which actually means within some, you know, 100 or 200 samples, you will reach this G infinity. Okay? So very short time, the solutions will converge if the conditions are met. Okay? So how do you find out the closed loop poles? So this can be done using, of course, you can solve for this determinant of this. It can be shown that it's also a solution of this generalized eigenvalue problem. And this particular solution, this particular equation is called as Euler equation for the linear quadratic problem. And you are guaranteed that for any choice of WU and WX, you know, you will get a stable solution. Okay, so stability and performance both are guaranteed by this particular approach. That is the key thing here. Okay, Now, see, these things, you read the derivations, and then, of course, once you start implementing it on, the reason I have given you the toy problem is because I want you to go back and implement it on a toy problem immediately. Okay, that is the way you will understand. In this course, if you do a lot of algebra, and you know, you cannot understand things even by solving some tiny problems of 2x2 matrices or 3x2 matrices. Actually, implement it on a real system, at least in a simulator, and see how it works. Okay, you now have phi gamma matrices. You start from a non-zero initial condition and see whether you go to the zero. Okay. So, of course, you can do what about we started this problem by saying x transpose wn into x, right? This objective function was formed with respect to x. If you have a model which is developed from data, then x may not have any physical meaning, only y has a physical meaning. So you can actually solve this problem, y transpose wy into u transpose w. You get this? All that I have changed is, instead of x transpose x, I have changed it to y transpose y. But this problem can be easily transformed into x transpose x problem. Yeah? This can be very easily transformed into x transpose x problem. So that is not an issue. So a problem which is originally y transpose y can be converted into x transpose x problem. Okay. What is this CR here? Is, you know, I have said that those outputs which you want to control. You may have modeled many outputs, not all of them you want to control. So CR will give you that part of the outputs from the states which you want to control. Okay. So this is, so you can convert a problem which is output regulation to, see, many times, you know, the model is developed not from physics, it's developed from data. In that case, X doesn't have physical meaning. So it is difficult to choose weighting matrices and all that. Only Y has a physical meaning. Y is a real measurement. So you can define a problem with respect to Y and convert it into a problem of X, because X and Y are related. Okay, you can convert that problem, and then you can solve this problem by, you choose Wx to be this, Wn to be this, and then you can solve the design problem. So that is, well, now let's relax one by one. We said that there is no state noise, there is no measurement noise. Okay, so what do I do if there is a state noise and measurement noise? What we do is, of course, we have a state observer, and then we have observer-controller pair. Okay, so my process dynamics is now this. Okay, so I am not going to ignore WK and VK. Okay, I am not going to ignore them. I will implement a Kalman predictor, for example. I can do this with Kalman filter also. I am just showing you this with Kalman predictor. That is because Kalman predictor, I have to deal only with one equation. It's easier to do algebra for me, so that's why I put Kalman predictor here. So this is my Kalman predictor. I'll get estimate of x hat k given k minus 1. Okay, my controller will be, it should be here, not lk, it should be gk here. Oh, sorry, this lk is the observer gain. This is the lk here is the, I made a mistake. It should be uk is equal to, this should be G infinity. Okay, and even here, this can be okay. Is this okay? So how am I going to take care of measurement noise and you know, state noise? I have an optimal state observer combined with the optimal controller. Okay, this is called as linear quadratic Gaussian control. Why this Gaussian business comes in? Because I am using Kalman filter to estimate the states, to construct optimal estimates of the states. Okay, I am using optimal way of computing the gain matrix using Riccati equations. So this is computed using another set of Riccati equations. This is computed using some other set of Riccati equations. So both cases, we have used the same theory. Okay, optimal estimation theory, optimal control theory. They are just, you know, mirror images in some sense. If you try to draw parallels, you will see that are very close parallels. Except one deals with something in future, other deals with something in the past. Okay. So you have this. So I can have this pair, optimal observer controller pair. And of course, I have to worry about whether this is, you know, jointly stable or not. So I'll be talking about what is called as a separation principle in my next lecture, where we'll talk about stability conditions, joint stability of Kalman filter and optimal controller pair. Okay, so they can be shown to be jointly stable. So if I design my observer to be optimal observer, which is Kalman filter, and then I design my controller to be optimal controller, linear quadratic optimal controller, and then I implement the control law through reconstruction of the states, then I am guaranteed that under nominal conditions they are jointly stable. Okay, I can separately design observer, I can separately design the controller, I can marry the two. Okay, that together they form a stable closed loop pair. Okay, effectively, if you see here, this is an output feedback controller. Why it is an output feedback controller? See, because how is x hat constructed? Using the model and measurement. Okay, so the measurement is fed back to this observer, which reconstructs the state. That state is used to compute UK, and that is injected here. Okay, see, the state is not measurable. So the idea of soft sensing is implicit here. I don't have direct measurement of X. I have only measurement of Y. Y is used through an observer to estimate X. Estimated X is used for closed loop control. Okay, I have a way of computing optimal gain for the observer given the noise model. Okay, I have a way of computing optimal gain for the controller given an performance objective. Okay, that I want to reduce it close to zero as fast as possible by considering the input weighting and all that. There is a problem here. First of all, we have to look at stability. Second thing, we have to see, you know, we said that non-zero initial condition to zero initial condition, very, very restrictive. I want to go from any output to any other output. I want to specify a set point and move from one set point to other set point, tracking. Okay. The second problem is there are drifting disturbances. There could be plant model mismatch. Okay. And then this controller will not give you offset-free behavior. How do you get offset-free behavior with this pair? Okay. You have to do some modifications to do that. The Kalman predictor, of course, I have just summarized here. Okay, so I need to do a couple of things. I need to now, so now I know how to compute gain matrices. Is that okay? I know how to compute observer gain matrix. I know how to compute optimal controller gain matrix. Now, having done that, I have to move on and talk about two things. Okay, what if the model and the plant are not matching? There is a mismatch between the plant and the model. What if the disturbances, see here, when we derived this Kalman filter, we said that this WK is a white noise. Okay, in reality, there could be a disturbance which is not a zero mean white noise. There could be a drifting disturbance. Okay, which is most likely the case in the real system. There is never, see, one example of, let's say, this disturbance modeling is when you are driving a car. So, you know, you have wind or air resistance. Okay, so air resistance, if there is no wind, but there is general motion of the air, it could be probably approximated as some white noise affecting the, you know, some local motions of air affecting your car. But if there is a strong wind in certain directions, then you cannot approximate it as a white noise. You know, that particular disturbance might be something like a colored noise. And then you have to account for it systematically in your controller calculations. So how do you do that? So that is going to be our next task. So now I want to move, yeah, so it's a problem of regulation, but for disturbances that are drifting. Okay, so how do I now modify my controller in such a way that I can account for drifting disturbances? Okay, I also account for the fact that the model and the plant may not be identical, there might be a mismatch. So so phi and gamma, which I'm assuming, might be different from what is actually there in the plant. I've identified them now, today. Okay. Over a period of time, the plant characteristics has changed. Okay. I'm still using the same old model. Okay. See, now that you are doing perturbations in the plant and collecting data, how many times you can keep doing this? You will do it once and then, you know, you will do it after some time. So in the meantime, the plant can change. Okay. So now what? Now will you be able to do the control with this? So I need to do some tricks to account for the fact that the model plant mismatch can develop over time. I also have to do something to make sure that I reject drifting unknown disturbances. Okay. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to modify my control law like this. Okay. I'm going to modify my control law. What was my originally control law? My control law was UK equal to minus, okay, and I wanted to go to origin, okay. Now what I'm going to say is that the origin itself is not fixed, okay. I'm modifying this control law by using a steady state target here. This excess is called as a target state, okay. So instead of saying that take x to the origin, I'm saying that take x to a target state excess. So difference between this should go to zero. Okay, what is this target state? How do I compute this target state? So I'm going to compute this US and XS, these two quantities. This is target input, this is the target state. Okay. This target input and target state are computed to account for two things. One is unmeasured disturbances. Second, it is computed to account for set point changes. See, I may want to move the system from one set point to other set point, okay, using the same controller. How do I do this? Okay, so that is going to be done by managing. So the control law looks very, very similar if you see here. Earlier my control law was UK equal to minus G into XK. I am just putting some compensation terms here. Okay, these compensation terms will allow me to take care of moving targets. It will allow me to take care of unknown disturbances. Okay, so excess represents the final steady state target. Okay, and that itself is changing as a function of time where I should reach, because it depends upon the drifting disturbances. And so this is a more realistic formulation of LQOC in which the disturbances are not white. Okay, the model is not perfect. Okay, I'm able to now, I will now solve a more realistic problem, okay, using, now, what I have sorted out till now is how to find out G infinity. Okay, all that I have sorted out till now is how to find out G infinity. Okay, having found out G infinity, now I'm going to modify my controller to take care of drifting disturbances, to take care of any set point. ओके. अर्लियर आई वॉज ओनली वरीड अबाउट मूविंग टू ओरिजिन 0 0, वेरी रिस्ट्रिक्टेड assumption. Now I want to change it to, so now how to do this, okay, that we'll see in the next lecture. You have to do a lot of so what I'll do now is I'll upload this, hopefully within a day or so I'll upload this. Well, and the thing that I'm expecting you to do is, as a part of your project, is implement these controllers, okay. Implement state feedback, implement the state observer, okay, in open loop first, and then implement linear quadratic optimal control and observer together and control your plant, okay. So that is what is, and actually when you do it, that is the time when you will learn it more, because this algebra here on the, you know, on the board becomes very, very messy, and then you don't get feel for what is happening unless you do it, you put your hands into it, you actually control one particular simulator, at least a simulated system, then you will get feel for what is really happening, okay. Upload this